Live from Locust Grove High School, this is Bell to Bell, featuring the music of harp and the harpsichords. Starting his own show, a man that doesn't need any introduction, but gets one anyway. Here's Tony Townsend.
Welcome, and thank you for joining us on this very special first episode of Bell to Bell. We'll be airing a live episode each month highlighting the phenomenal work going on right here at Locust Grove High School. We have a great show lined up for you today. We'll be hearing from our senior, Mr. Johnny Chapman, our very own personalized learning lead, Ms. Kate Bailey, and last but definitely not least, Dr. Azelle Harrell from the LGHS Math Department. Mr. Pipkin, harpsichords, let's get this thing started. All right. So I've got my own talk show now. I've got my own band. I've got my own host. I feel like I've really made it. I feel like if this principal thing doesn't work out, I know where to go from this point forward. Pipkin, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. Look, someone told me that today was supposed to be Ugly Sweater Day, but I don't see the ugly sweater on you.
That has got to be the ugliest thing I've ever seen in my life.
Wow.
Where did you get that?
So it's my ugly sweater, and it does win every single competition. So it is the best you'll ever see, no doubt about it. Speaking of you having some jokes, we start the show every episode with a joke of the day from Ms. Pritchett.
Let's hear it.
Ms. Pritchett has a joke of the day just to make math a little more fun here. So let's see what Ms. Pritchett's got for us. You ready?
I'm ready.
You sure?
I am so ready.
You're gonna get this?
Yes, maybe.
Why do crabs have no friends?
Have no idea. Why do crabs have no friends? Have no idea.
Like, not even a guess?
Because they're crabby? I don't know.
Okay, that's terrible. Because they are shellfish.
Oh, that's funny. That's hilarious. I hope Miss Pritchett has better ones next time.
And that does remind me, we are shooting this live. We have a live audience, even though that may have sounded like canned laughter. We have a live audience. We have a live band and a live host. That's debatable. But we are standing 6 feet apart. We're keeping all those social guidelines in mind. You will even see when I have a guest come up that we have our own shield to make sure that we are kept far, far away from each other. So someone's going to need to clean that a little bit later. But we are making sure that we are safe and following those safety guidelines throughout the course of this show. Speaking of masking up and keeping safe, a couple months ago, Henry County Schools challenged us to create a video for the Mask Up Challenge. Don't challenge us to create a video, because if you do, we're going to destroy it. And destroy it, we did. Our very own Michael Jackson came in with the theme of Beat It to this Mask Up Challenge. Before we welcome our guest out here, let's take a look at the video. Let's roll it.
I know it's going to be different coming back to school, but if we wash our hands, if we keep our social distance, and we mask up, we're going to beat it.
What an outstanding video that was, and so much fun to make. Let's call out the real star of that show, Mr. Johnny Chapman.
Yeah. Nice. Good job, Donnie. Welcome.
Welcome, Mr. Chapman.
Thank you for having me.
Isn't this amazing that I have my own show?
Yes, this is just amazing.
Did you see our coffee cup? Did you see that we got our own coffee cup? It's got my name on it, even. Isn't that amazing? So, that video was outstanding. Your dancing was amazing. The choreography was so cool. But let's talk about it here just a little bit. So, walk me through that video. What was it like to shoot that video?
It was a really amazing experience, and it's one that I will cherish forever. And I was just really so amazing, so really honored to be in that that situation. And with all that's going on, I was happy that I was able to bring some joy to some people. And I also heard that we went viral on Twitter and on YouTube and on Facebook, so that kind of lifted up my spirits a little bit.
That's terrific. I don't know if we should really go viral with anything right now. That's probably not the best use of words, but we'll go with it anyway, okay? Just joking. So let me ask another question. As a student here at Locust Grove High School, what do you feel about this school and how you could be celebrated with your unique style and unique personality? Talk to me a little bit about that.
So this school is really a great atmosphere, and it really has a lot of amazing ways that you can express yourself to you and to your peers. Like, I am not only am I a dancer, I'm also a drummer in the guitar club, and that is a really huge way for me to actually show my musical and performing abilities, and also to express it to everyone else.
And that is absolutely amazing, because I feel like here at Locust Grove High School, we can have students that show that passion and can dive into that passion, but as a community and culture, we also have service always in mind with everything that we do. Have there been things that have happened here at school that's helped support that goal for you?
Yes, of course. Being able to be in the guitar club, like I said, and then I was able to be also in a pep rally, not once, but twice, and I got to be able to part of a dance-off, and I want to say I won that dance off, and also I got to perform in front of the lunchroom. That was my first debut.
If you could give one piece of advice to any future student or parent of Locust Grove High School, what would that piece of advice be?
I tell them that they're going to really be able to follow their dreams here, because the school gives everything that a student needs and wants to be able to move successful in their careers.
That's outstanding. Thank you so much, Johnny, for being my very first guest of my own very first show. Next up, speaking of that passion, we have Miss Kate Bailey coming to us talking about capstones. Be right back. The ha-ha's might actually work pretty well.
As the lame... Yeah.
Now that was dynamite.
That's awesome.
No, that was good. That was good. That's focused. It was tight. Good job. Good job.
It was me. It was not you. It was me.
You'll come in
the
can.
Bah! Just like that scare it up challenge.
And welcome back to Bell to Bell. We have with us now our instructional and personalized learning lead for Locust Grove High School, Ms. Kate Bailey. Ms. Bailey, welcome to the show. How exciting is this? This is pretty cool, isn't it? Amazing stuff, amazing stuff. So we've learned a little bit about the capstone process. So from your perspective, what categories or what projects do kids typically pick when they do their capstones?
So the cool thing about our capstone is that there isn't a specific topic that students usually gravitate towards. In fact, I'm kind of notorious for saying there's a capstone in that. So if you're a student athlete, there's a capstone in that. If you're a gamer and a coder, there's a capstone in that. If you're in theater or in art, there's a place for you at Locust Grove High School, and we want to help you find what that capstone topic is.
We a lot of times award credit based on what they do, right? So talk to us a little bit about that. How does a kid get course credit from doing the work within the capstone?
Okay, so when it comes to earning academic credit in your capstone, you have to be diligent about getting the standards that are in each of the classes you're currently taking. So if you're taking a math course or an ELA course, ask your teacher for those standards, and then what you'll want to do is sort through those standards and see what matches the work you're doing in your capstone. Once you've made those matches, you want to go to your teacher.
Merry Christmas!
Yeah, is this a blooper reel? Listen, I was doing a great job on answering that question.
Okay, you can hit stop.
I've been waiting to do this.
Oh my. So Miss Johnson would scare me too. So let me give you a second to collect your thoughts again, and then we'll get right back to your answer regarding that last question.
Okay, so to kind of finish up that answer, once you have made those matches, looking at the standards and matching it to your capstone topic, you just want to approach your teacher and ask for credit to see if you've mastered that standard. And I think it's important to note that it really takes pulling all those standards and looking through them to make those matches, because you might have a match that you wouldn't think you did. So for instance, we had kids a couple of years ago who did a hunting capstone, and it had to do with bullet trajectory. And so you might initially think that that doesn't connect to any content, but it did. It connected to physics, it connected to their math courses, and it certainly connected to ELA because of the research they were doing. So there are more connections than you think that there are.
So we've talked a lot about how capstone and passion work can help the kids while they're in the school, but what about life after school? What does that look like for a kid that leaves our building? How can they use this in the future?
So we obviously care that the capstone matters to students when they're here. We want kids to have a place to go every single day to kind of geek out over something that they really love. And so we offer that while they are present in Locust Grove High School. However, obviously we're thinking with the end in mind. So we want to be thinking about how this is going to positively impact kids when they leave Locust Grove High School. Doing any kind of capstone work is something that's essential in post-secondary school, so we believe that we're setting kids up for that post-secondary school success if they've already been exposed to it in high school. Not only that, but they also are more likely to get a job or get accepted into a college based on any kind of service that they've done or any kind of big project that they've led. And so we hope that the capstone is a great talking point for any interview or any application going forward.
And yeah, that's exactly right. Kids can use this to gain scholarships. They could use this for interviews. They could use this for portfolios. So it's really limitless what a kid can take this information and do with it as they move into their own future. And that's what it's built for. We want kids to be able to take what they're passionate about, get course content credit for it, but more importantly, use this as they go into the real world, whether that's college, career, or whatever world the world takes them into. So awesome stuff, awesome work from the capstones themselves. Miss Bailey, thank you so much for your participation today and being one of our first guests of Bell to Bell. We'll be back in just a few moments. The harpsichords take us out.
Chicken Run of Locust Grove on Peaksville Road has been providing breakfast, lunch, and dinner to the Locust Grove community for over a decade, where the buffalo chicken biscuit and sandwiches are a must-have for the Locust Grove High School students. Food is always cooked fresh to order. Never leave without a large cup of our signature sweet tea. Dine in or carry out. Call ahead for speedy services in our drive-thru. Open Monday through Saturday, always closed on Sunday. Chicken Run, where champions eat.
And welcome back. Bell to Bell has been such a great experience already today. It's just going to continue to get better with our next guest. We've got Dr. Izelle Harrell coming out. She's one of our math teachers. Such an incredible lady, such an incredible teacher. She's taught at all different levels. She's written curriculum. She's just done it all, really. And it's such a pleasure now to get her perspective on what this has been like to be a teacher teaching through a pandemic. So if you will, let's welcome out our next guest, Dr. Izelle Harrell. Dr. Harrell, welcome. first and foremost. Second, did you ever think that you would ever come out to your own music?
No, I never thought I would have a theme song other than the one that plays in my head.
that's good stuff. Hopefully that's the only thing playing in your head, but I can only imagine how difficult it's been for you to teach under the current circumstances. So just a few questions for you. When it comes to teaching today as opposed to teaching last year or the year before, what have been the biggest differences you've seen?
One of the big differences, I think, for me is that I've been doing this for so long, specifically with math. I used to be able to just walk into the classroom, and if something wasn't going right, I would change gears right in the middle of things. And I didn't really have to think a whole lot about it because I knew what the standards were and I knew what I needed to convey. Now it takes so much more prep because it's not just the kids that are in face-to-face. I have to make sure that if I have to make adjustments on the fly, which we do as teachers, I have all the plans in place for the students that are remote so that they can get the same kind of experience and not get lost in the shuffle.
That's so good. My next question for you, when it comes to the amount of work that you have to put in, because it's different now, right? What does that look like?
Lots of hours at home, weekends. I have to make sure that I'm able to communicate with face-to-face kids, with remote kids, and it needs to seem seamless. And so that takes a whole lot of behind-the-scenes work that used to not be as big of an issue.
Absolutely. Next question I have for you. What do you think of my sweater?
I love your sweater, Mr. Townsend. Like, it's just the best.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much. That's a great answer. I like that answer. Next question for you. What would you consider to be the most challenging part to your job right now, aside from lying about my sweater?
The most challenging part is making sure that I can reach kids both digitally and in person and have it seem like it's still just one big classroom. That's a lot harder than it sounds because there are mic issues, there are connectivity issues, and we have to kind of work around all of that so that the kids can talk to each other, whether they're all face-to-face or part at home or, you know, it just makes it a challenge.
Absolutely. Last thing I have for you, what's been the biggest success that you've had through all this?
I'll let you know when I have it. we've had small victories. There are days that I leave thinking, okay, that worked. There are days that I leave in tears thinking, okay, I got to try something different because that did not work. And that's just kind of the nature of being a teacher, but I think it's heightened now because we have those small snippets of time, you know, and we don't know what's going to happen with the pandemic and how long we're going to be hybrid or any of that. So I have to make sure that every day, every class, every minute counts.
Absolutely. I know that big success story is going to happen. And maybe when it does, you can come back on the show and make sure you share that with us as well. We will have future episodes of Bell to Bell. But for now, I want to thank our guests for the day, Dr. Harrell, Ms. Bailey, Mr. Johnny Chapman. I want to thank our host, Mr. Pipkin, our band, Pat Harp and the Harpsichords. Be sure to tune in next month. In between, make sure that you're also tuning into the Wildcat News that airs daily and is uploaded to our website. For now, stay healthy, my friends, and good night.